Welcome back from that short break. You're still watching Aben Today right here on Aben Television. Getting into our Kachai conversation this morning, we are going to be talking about the revival of Mchaka Mchaka. For those of you who remember this during the early years of 2000s, it was very vital for every youth to make sure that they had this in their skills. And of course, the president and his team have come up to say that this is something that should be taken up by all youth that are 30 years and below. That's, of course, consisting to about 21% of Uganda's population. Now, this morning, we're going to be discussing with a colleague of ours all the way from the New Vision Department, Nicholas Wasaja, who's going to be giving us details regarding this Mchaka Mchaka, which has been put under the National Youth Service Bill. And we'd like to get to know and understand what does this bill have to do with anything to do with the youth. Good morning to you, Nicholas.
Good morning.
How are you doing?
I'm okay. How are you doing?
Very fantastic. Let's get into, you know, this Mchaka Mchaka and, of course, the likes of it. Let's begin with the bill. First and foremost, could you give us an insight of what this bill is about?
Well, the National Youth Service Bill is apparently now a government bill, but it first came in 2016 as a private member's bill that was being sponsored by Chewalabye Majegere, and then seconded by Mwene Mpaka. He's a youth MP from Western Uganda. So it was initially the National Graduate Service Scheme Bill, and the soul of the bill was to give employability skills to young people that have graduated from the university, and they were supposed to be taken through training, hands-on training, either in a private or public sector. But it suffered a setback when the Labour Minister Herbert Kabafunzachi argued then that it is against the constitution because you cannot employ someone without paying them. People have a right to pay. However, I think he did not comprehend very well the contents of the bill, because the bill talked about a stipend that, for example, if you were in the public or public-private sector like we are in the New Vision, and you are doing that 1 year, you would be paid by those entities. And if you're in a purely private sector, then you would be paid by what they call the National Youth Service Secretariat. I think that would also be government money, just a stipend like it is for intern doctors. The reasoning was that this will do away with the excuse that employers normally give that when you're fresh from the university, you do not have the experience to be employed. So they thought it would be a good thing, and then also inculcate the spirit of voluntarism. However, the government has since taken it on and renamed it the National Youth Service Bill. Apparently, the principles have been approved, according to Minister Florence Nachiwala. The principles have been approved by have been drafted, but awaiting approval by cabinet. From there, it will go to what they call the first parliamentary legal council. That drafts it into something that is comprehensible, the legal terms and all the gymnastics. And the issues now the new bill has shifted away largely from having a voluntary service for their graduates to now talking about having issues like the kind of service that they would want is a training in clusters, primary and secondary and other tertiary institutions, where in primary school they will take you through sexual reproduction, they will take you through
HIV
and then the campaigns against the corruption, and then at secondary level, and then you attain a certificate at that point, and then at secondary level they will take you through things like entrepreneurship, patriotism, unity, and then paramilitary training. That is what we call Mchaka Mchaka, which has been there. But you would also want to appreciate that this is not a new thing. We have neighbors like in Kenya, in Tanzania, they are doing it, in Nigeria. In Kenya, they started in 1964. President Milton Obote 1967 had initially proposed a national youth service scheme, but it never took off because his term was short-lived. In Nigeria, it's been since 1973, around there. And for it, even if you've studied abroad, but you would want to work in Nigeria, when you come back, you're subjected to the voluntary scheme with a small stipend, and then you're employed into the national service at a later date. That is the bottom line of that.
Nicholas, understanding that we are focusing on the youth, that is someone who's 30 years and below, as of course approximately up to 18 years of age, understanding the fact that some people have been lucky enough to get employment, get jobs immediately after the university, but they lie within that bracket, where does this exercise leave them? Where does this bill leave them? Does that mean that they're going to, you know, go off work to focus on this exercise, which is going to be happening for a year? Where is that leaving these young men?
The new bill being proposed by government covers both illiterate and semi-literate. For example, if you've graduated from if you dropped off at senior four and or even senior three and went into vocational or tertiary education, still it would cover you within the same age bracket. You get it. What it doesn't address really is if, for example, you stopped in senior two and then probably dropped off to ride a boda, it doesn't really cover that because it's a more informal sector. It's hard to track. You know, government has had issues even itself raising revenue within the informal sector. So unless government goes back and really thinks critically on how to get people that are not within the formal structures to be involved in the national policies and the laws and everything, my thinking is it's still going to be hard, because how are you going to track down someone who is stopped in a P7 and they are probably doing a farming somewhere?
Does the bill stipulate anything to do with someone who is working for, say, maybe, like, I'll give an example, Vision Group, someone who is below the age of 30 years? Does that mean that they are going to forego their job at Vision to take part in this practice? Does the bill say anything regarding someone who is already employed?
I think we are waiting to look at the bill comprehensively. What we did as New Vision was go out and talk to the relevant authorities, and they gave us a snippet of what is in the bill. However, my thinking is it wouldn't be prudent for someone who is already employed, because the issue is dealing with people that have not yet been employed. Things are to deal with things like ethics and that is why they emphasize things like corruption and unity and patriotism, basically to do with ethics and then what it really means to serve. So if you've already been in employment, then probably you've been introduced to these kind of values that the country wants to inculcate into the young people.
All right. In case you're out there and you want to be part of the conversation, it's very simple. In case you have your phone, your personal computer, or even your tab, you can as well head over to our social media pages for Urban Television, that is Facebook, and at Urban TV Uganda, that is Twitter. You can leave your comment. And in case you have any questions regarding the bill for Nicholas, we'll definitely check that out, and he will be able to answer. Not forgetting, studio lines will also be open. The number to call is right there on your screens. In case you have any hard-pressing question, you can as well give us a call right about now in studio and get to understand more that this bill has to offer regarding bettering the youth for better employment in the country. Willis, there's a conversation that we're having a little bit earlier on, and this is something that you have always forefronted from way back. What do you make of this whole situation right now? Now that we're with Nicholas in studio, you could be having any support.
For me, I like the direction that we're taking, although I think that we are going to a bit sideline what I envisioned and thought would be helpful for Uganda. One is that we shouldn't be talking about how much these young people are going to get. We should be talking about how much these young people are going to put in for Uganda as a whole to gain. And the other thing I'm also worried about is that if we put this to only military training and, you know, that sort of discipline, I think we lose the bigger picture. We have lots of other sectors where Uganda can gain from these young people and, you know, talk about farming, talk about mining, the oil pipes need to be laid. We have lots of very young, energetic people who can be of use in that area. So I think if we can enlarge, expand on you know, the base of where these young people are going to go, then Uganda can stand to gain. When we do that, then we can now sit down and say, okay, what do these young people gain out of this? You understand? What does a young person at 28, probably after they're done with campus, what do they gain out of this? Then we can start that conversation. However, I think that we're heading in the right direction. I hope that those can be put there. Although I feel like, you know, I don't know how government is going to enforce it because we have lots of young people who have, you know, probably, like you said, stepped out of S2 and they've already started working. How is government going to then push them back into service to something that, you know, is not going to give them a lot of money? Because if you say that you're going to pay these young people, then you're going to have the conversations that the doctors are having. We want our money increased. We are doing internship, but we want our money increased. And you're asking yourself, wait a minute, you're not yet a doctor. Why are you talking about pay? Take the little you have plus the knowledge that you're gaining. You understand? We need to teach people that it's better to take knowledge out of something than money, because money disappears. That car 1 million that you want at the end of the month, so you can spend it in actually a week.
That's right.
So why don't you focus on getting the skills than getting the money?
Nicholas, what do you say regarding to what Willis is saying? Understanding that we are, you know, forefronting this bill to make, you know, the youth better people for jobs, and of course making sure that we move below the poverty line. But before you answer that question, I think we do have a phone call that we'd like to address first. Yes, hello, good morning. Hello? I think we lost that one. Try giving us a call. The number to call is 0414-337872. Nicholas, according to Willis, like I mentioned, for him, he believes that, you know, the youth should not look out to how much they are going to earn, but, you know, rather the skill that they should take home. What do you make of that remark?
I think Bruce is absolutely right. It's sad that this country is degenerating to and zeroing everything, attaching everything to the monetary value that is in it. Mfunirawa. And for me, in as much as I believe this bill is good, in whichever way you look at it, it's very good. But I think that the youth challenge is way larger than just the policies and the laws. It goes back to the fundamentals of what do we have in the family today? We have absence of parents. What do we have in schools today? We have absence of teachers. Why do we have absence of teachers? Because we probably do not have enough motivational things to keep them around. Yesterday, I was in the newsroom and people were working on a story in Karamoja, where you have teachers and students coming in at lunchtime, make very long queues for food, and then by 2 p.m. the whole school is empty. But they have all. Why is this so? So I think there is so much soul searching that government still needs to do to address this challenge. It's bigger than just the policies, because even if you said when you talk about corruption, for example, today if you're going to tell me about corruption and how I have to work very hard to earn my way into life, yet I'm seeing my seniors move from just stealing money to printing money. Last time we were in a committee, and a UNRA official was telling the Kosase MPs that, well, stop probing us about millions of shillings. We UNRA deals with billions of money, so it doesn't matter if someone walks away with some 500 million. So what do you expect me as a young man who is writing about that story? What do you expect me to do when I... It's way larger than just the policies. We need to do a lot, and it involves the whole society. It's not only government. It's not only the youth. Everyone has to be involved if we have to get this country back on the right track.
Nicholas, looking at the fact that you're dealing with a group of members that form the country, the youth, 21.3% to be exact, of Uganda's population is for the youth. Don't you think at some particular point it's going to become overwhelming for the government to handle this? I'm going to relate it to the universal primary education, something that has been in existence for a couple of years, but up to now we still have hitches here and there as far as, you know, bettering UPE is concerned, which has still been a problem for the country. Now, bringing it back to, you know, this bill and what it is going to entail, given the number of the youth in the country, don't you feel like it's going to become suppressing for the government?
One, like the president said, having a youthful population is advantageous because it increases productivity. You will read, they will tell you that in traditional society, men used to think that the way they married was, I have four women. If I have four women and each of them gives me about five boys or gives me about five children, then that increases my productivity. So a population is not a challenge per se. My issue would be prioritizing. If the government considers that skilling the youth, making them employable is a priority, then you should focus on it as a priority. The challenge that has been with the UPE that you talk about is how resources are allocated. For me, I don't believe you're going to move into industrialization and infrastructure development before developing human capacity. What is the quality of the human capacity of the human resource that we are churning out? It is way below average. And this is the reason as to why now people are thinking of things like the graduate scheme, because people do not have employable skills. You get it. But if we prioritize, if we talk about issues like if we decide as a country that probably the first thing that we need is education, we need to educate people, we need to empower them.
We prioritize it.
Then we move on to the next thing, other than being here and there and there.
Let's pick a caller we have online and we get to find out what they have to say regarding this bill in Parliament. Yes, hello, good morning.
Good morning.
How are you doing?
I'm fine, thank you. Only the proud imitator.
Yes, Opio.
To be honest, my brothers, thank you, Nicholas. How are you today?
I'm fine, thank you.
Okay. The thing here is, really, we do not need money from the government, but I think we need to have good fields of work, sport fields where people can, you know, when we have too many things, the government can put the institute. Very many kids out there can actually be cleaners, can actually be things. But if the government comes out and starts giving money to an individual, money is nothing. Okay. But if the government can build something bigger, whereby people, the youth can be going there to exchange the ideas, have sport time, or even dancing clubs, someone can earn a living through that. So we really don't need money from the government. Like me as myself, I'm telling you guys, even if the government comes and says, hey, Phil, we're giving you 100 million now. Because I know, I have no idea. But if I have a place where I can always be going to work, or I can also be going to teach something, I know I will take my family long, long, long way. So really, the idea here is not all about money for the youth. Because the government of Uganda, trust me, has no idea to pay the youth. Even if it used to be paid 10,000 shillings, the government of Uganda will never manage to do that in every month. Look at these teachers. Look at the old people who have been there, who have been the workers in government. Actually, even they are suffering. So if the youth who are growing day and night, they have so many needs. So actually, the government will never handle this. The government should just open the society, build different things where people can have their ideas exchange.
Okay.
Yes, that's it. Thank you, my brother.
All right, thank you very much, Opio.
I'd like to disagree with Opio on one thing that, and this is, I don't blame him, I probably blame I blame it on the government for not opening the minds of young people. The older generation will tell you that for them in their time when they studied, you find a guy who was born in Kabale studying in Soroti for O-level and going to probably down south or north. Exactly. So the cost of destroying that infrastructure, that status quo that they've built is very high. So that's why you see the older people will tell you, let's not push this, government, let's not push our society into turmoil. Because they've seen the beauty of Uganda, they've seen how far Uganda has come, they've traveled. For us now, you find a young person telling you, even if the guys in Guru demonstrate, but you ask him, have you ever been to Guru? Do you know what is in Guru? And they don't know.
He has no idea.
Government should put in place, like in that bill, I think one of the things they should consider is that before you apply, before you get an admission letter at a university, you should be putting on a uniform of service that you served. We don't want the certificate, but the uniform with the badge.
I think that's one of the things that they're trying to look into before you ask for any job. They need that certificate.
Yeah.
Then probably then the
be in uniform, because course you can forge a certificate, but a badge has to be original.
I think Opio's concern was the cost.
Before you address Opio's concern, let's pick another caller. Maybe you can address them at once. Yes, hello, good morning.
Morning, how are you?
Very good. Your name and where you're watching us from?
Hello?
Hello, you're live on Urban Television?
Yes, I'm live on.
Yes, your name and where you're watching us from?
I'm going to Francis from Mbale.
Francis from Mbale, what do you make of, you know, this bill whereby we shall have the youth undergo military training and a couple of other skills? I think we lost that one. Yes, hello? We have another caller? Hello? Hello?
Hello?
Yes, good morning. I think we lost that one. The network is quite not well. But the number to call is right there on your screen, 0414-337-8-72. Let's come back to you, Nicholas, as far as we have another caller. Yes, hello? I think we lost. Let's hold it on with the phone lines. Let's first address Opio's remarks. Nicholas, what do you make of Opio?
I think on Opio's Opio's concern was the cost. Mm-hmm. That if you say everyone that goes into voluntary service has to be paid a stipend, how much are you going to pay?
Mm.
You get it. It might become overwhelming, like you said initially, and then at the end of the day, people are going to abandon it. You're going to have sit-down strikes, like it is with the medical interns.
Mm.
So my thinking is it should be tailored in such a way that the way it is with the national IDs right now. Right now, you can't do anything serious. Mm. You can't register for anything serious if you do not have a national ID.
That's
we
true.
Should get to a level, because in the Scandinavian countries, it is being done. Mm. And it's free of charge.
Yeah.
Your parents take care of you. You have to go and serve. You get it. Without a certificate of service, voluntary service, you're not employable in that country. So I think that is where we should get at. And then at the end of the day, you'll have employers who know that it is possible for you to serve without necessarily attaching monetary value to the service you do.
Let's pose it to the viewers right then. We get to hear what they have to say before we run out of time. Yes, another caller. Hello? Hello?
I'm going to Francis from Paris.
Yes, Francis, you're back. I was asking you, what do you make of, you know...
with that, this young man, this man who is on the right side.
Okay, me. Willis, yes.
But people in Uganda that have gone far with education.
Mm. Mm. Francis?
And for me, I think that people that have gone far, Ugandans that have gone far about education, and I think that maybe education is not the key, but it's not. Getting for yourself the job. So for me, I'm in Uganda, but I used to drop out from senior, but I used to make my own business. Right now, I'm a big fan of Zimbabwe, but education is nothing. But it's all about how can you plan for yourself.
Mm. Okay.
I think I understand where he's coming from. And for me, I will say this.
Mm.
You're 28, you're looking for a job, and you're claiming that you don't have a job because government is not creating jobs. No, you're not unemployed.
Mm.
You are not informed, you're not educated, you have no skill. What are you doing being counted as unemployed?
Let's pick another caller right there. Yes, hello, good morning. Hello. You're live on Urban Today. Please turn down the volume on your TV set. I think we lost some. Let's try and pick one last caller before we get to wrap up with this one. Hello?
Let's tell these guys to go.
Mm.
Before you get into university, before you ask for a job, you must have served for a year. At least in a NADS firm, in a government firm, at a military base, in a health facility, for free. Let a government invest in creating uniforms for these guys.
Mm.
Let government invest in accommodation for these guys.
Mm.
And let them just provide them with meals. You understand? So if you provide someone with those basics, let them serve for free.
For free.
It also helps in someone to love their country more.
Mm.
Because in 10 years when they're in a job, they take care of their country better. We have people arguing, you know, that we should give away Murchison Falls. Guys who have not been there, guys who don't know what takes place there. But, you know, if these guys were there, if these guys went deep into Uganda more, they would appreciate Uganda and we would have a different conversation.
Someone out there may, you know, want to deflect away from you when you say that these people should be served for free. Nevertheless, if I feel like if they're given these basic needs, food, shelter, and whatever they'll need, medical and name it, this could be an incentive for them to use, maybe.
This incentive mentality is for this.
You're not very sure.
You know the chicken that lay eggs, the white chicken that lay eggs?
The layers.
All they do is sit and wait to be given. That is the mentality that we have right
Willis,
now.
Willis, you're not going to be able
to employ
21.3% individuals in the country at the same time.
Yes.
So how about you give these people a small incentive, and as you give them these skills, impact them practical
the incentive
and skills
as I'm giving you as a young person is to give you a place where you'll get a free skill. Government is giving you a free skill.
I think what he's saying is that it's not sustainable to give them an incentive in terms of money. But if you construct a house and you know that after 1 year Bruce is going to move out and Nicholas is going to move on and do the same and do the same work, probably they'll be growing their own food like some schools do right now. So it's a bit more sustainable than simply saying I'm going to give you 100,000 because you might not have the money at the end of the day. So I think that is the bottom argument. Yes, let government create avenues where they can sustain, they can live a modest life, but they do work without necessarily attaching money to it.
What will you use money for? I mean,
if I take you to Kichwamba tea factory and you're going to be there for 1 year, what are you going to use the money for?
I could, you know, have my own tea farm.
No, you're at the farm. You're working at the farm.
But it's
I'm
not
giving
mine.
You clothes. You're eating. You're sleeping.
It's not mine. I would want to have my own tea farm.
That is a very wrong notion. And I think we've all got it wrong. People that advocate for entrepreneurship and starting own enterprises. It's a whole wrong concept. I think it is very important for young people to understand that the only way you can develop into someone that can start their own thing is by knowing how this is done. I mean, you can't move out of journalism school and start an app and TV.
Do we have some callers online? We get to wrap up. Just two lucky callers. Hello, good morning.
Yeah, good morning. How are you?
Very good. How are you? Your name and where you're watching us from?
My name is Max Elijah Musito.
Yes, Musito. Where are you watching us from?
I'm watching from Old Kampala, actually.
Okay. What do you make of today's topic?
Well, when I look at my brother on the right, he's a very young man if I look at him. But his mentality kind of militarization of civilians, it does not apply. Okay, let me tell you. You see, when you look at countries that have militarized their citizens, they have failed at it. I'll give you an example. Do you see Eritrea? People are running out of there because they are forced into that deliberate training.
Okay.
North Korea is doing the same. Where are they in terms of development? Government's role is to plan for the people, is to put up avenues, is to put up factories, company, but I wouldn't refer much when it comes to serving as well. Now, if you want people to come in and serve and work for government, you have to provide them with free education. When you offer them free education, those that have been sponsored by government could actually be pulled into working for government for a certain period of time, or joining in the lines of government and its political stuff, whereby people go and train and do stuff like that. But before you embark on that, you must have a strategy.
Okay?
You must have a strategy. So he talked about layers, my friend. If you put a chicken layer out in the field, it will fend for itself and it will give you eggs. You understand that?
So what you're trying to say
of thinking people in Uganda, guys are weak, like the president put it the other day, that majority of the youth are not ready to work and stuff. It's the environment. You have polluted the environment by bringing in fake investors in the country who cannot actually think for the population. You give them free land, you give them free stuff, and then you embark on saying, there's no land for cultivation. You have cut down land into pieces, blah, blah, blah. That kind of thing.
Okay.
You forget that you give these people investors free land instead of giving your locals free land. You understand where we're going. So, my brother, the young brother, you're still young. I disagree, totally disagree with the mentality you are injecting in the population. Let's put the government on task.
Okay.
The government has to have a 10-year, 20-year program. It is aware that the generation is growing. It's aware, because when the president came in power, I think we were about 5, 10 million. Now we are about 45 million or something.
Yes.
Now, and put up strategies. You know, the number of youth are increasing so much. You know, the population is growing. And every country is actually working towards the youth. Then you're wrong. Barack Obama, when he came into presidency, do you know who he used to become a president? He used the youth. He started from varsity.
Thank you very much, Mr.
40 seconds for me for him. Number one, he's talking about, you know, that it's wrong to get young people and take them out there to work. But listen, the young people that you're talking about and saying it's wrong for me to suggest that they should go and work on farms, I think that you misunderstand my point. My point is that the young people go to work on farms for two purposes. One is to get skills for themselves.
Yes.
And two is to have a part to play in the formation of the big cake that they demand so bitterly about. When young people go on the streets to demonstrate about their part of the cake, they demonstrate with bitterness. But most of them, if you ask them, they don't know how the cake is formed. So we need young people to be a part of formation of the cake. The other point that he's talking about is that...
streamlining. He says there's lack of streamlining. The government needs to have a structure to make sure that this is able to work.
It's going to work. It's going to work. If you remove the aspect of paying these young people and make these young people contribute rather than feel like they are working, it will work. If, for example, if you have a 28-year-old a 21 who has finished senior six and take them for a year to lay pipes of oil, by the time they go to campus to do a different course, they'll have knowledge about oil. So they will
probably
go in the oil.
Want to do an engineering course.
Exactly. So we need to appreciate the fact that I think government has brought up a good bill and it's going to help the young people in later years.
Nicholas, in just 1 minute, your response to Musitwa right there and as we get to wrap up.
Musitwa, nobody is letting the government off the hook. Government has a role to play. And I think policy formulation and legislating on laws is one of the roles that it does play. I entirely agree with you. But my thinking is the proposal for paramilitary training is anchored on purely political interests. You get it? That is why government was vehement to say, this is, we have a lot of interest in this bill. We can't let a private member sponsor it. You get it? However, we should also agree that we all have a responsibility. Youth should be part of the solution. And and for me, the argument has always been thinking that we are going to think, people, policymakers are going to think the solution for the youth is wrong. The youth must think the solutions for themselves because they lie within us. You get it? When you have conversations with them, people have the solutions. You get it? For example, if government is saying, well, we might not have the money to pay you a stipend, go back to them, consult amongst them. What do you think can be done to sustain the program? And in that way, when you involve them, it works. This is a policy that is owned. Policy should not only be written on paper and shelved.
Should be. I'll give you a personal example. I know how to go to the, you know, to a farm, buy maize, put it on a truck, put it to the market and sell it. Guess how I learned it? I never got a salary to learn it. I moved from Kampala, went to a village, stayed and learned it. That's a skill I learned for free. I didn't get paid and I didn't pay someone.
And now you're earning.
Thank
you very much, Nicholas, for coming to our studio. Of course, it's always an interesting conversation that we never want to let go. But because of the interest of time, we definitely have to let you just leave your comment on our social media pages and we'll definitely dive into some feedback right there. The bill is still in parliament and in case it is passed into a law, we'll definitely also keep you informed and some of the nitty gritties that will be coming through regarding this bill. Continues immediately right after this break.